can I make sure that what I do as a physician demonstrates the love of God and the mercy of God and the hope of God? From an early point in my childhood, I can remember watching the first moon landing on a black and white TV and thinking, I want to do that job. So I just pursued that. Then was able to get into an aerospace medicine residency program to work for NASA as a flight surgeon, providing health care for the astronauts and their families. It really was a dream come true. But in many ways, my identity was not as a follower of Jesus Christ, but my identity had become, I'm a flight surgeon working for NASA. I really didn't think that I would leave NASA. God said, you need to make a choice. It was in our living room. I'm saying to God, this job is cool, but I don't need it. I need you. Whatever you want to do, I'm ready.
When he finally came to me and told me that this is what he felt called to do, I just said, I've been waiting.
God moved us to the country of Uganda, where we served for 12 and a half years. From there, moved south to Lesotho, and then God brought us to Kigoma Baptist Hospital, where we've been serving for the last 7 years. In western Tanzania, it literally is at the end of the road because we're right on the Lake Tanganyika. God has placed us in an area that is predominantly Islamic. Healthcare in our part of the world, there is a great limitation on resources that are available. We have patients that are admitted with severe malaria, dysentery. Every year we have an outbreak of cholera. We don't have the adequate numbers of resources and personnel on the field to be able to meet all the needs.
But we have partnerships with a number of different churches and on various levels.
When a church comes in and partners with us to provide that kind of care, it literally changes the people's lives, both physically but also spiritually. Using healthcare strategies is like a key that opens the door to get into a village that we might not have access to. Not far outside of the town that we live in is a small village.
Completely unreached on the fringes of town.
We met with local leaders and we asked permission to come to that village and do a week-long medical dental eye clinic. Through that opportunity, God used that to start a new church plant.
That village has been a huge impact.
Growing in their faith in Jesus Christ and being discipled. Just this past week, one person came and repented and said, no, I need this Jesus. The kingdom of light is coming in Tanzania, bursting through the darkness like we've never seen before.
Well, you're going to have that opportunity to give towards that mission effort for the Lottie Moon mission for this month. That opportunity comes up in the service today, so you be praying about what you can give. And then also pray for those missionaries. We have a personal relation, don't we, with at least one that is overseas. And so you pray for them. Pray that God would show you what you can give today towards that mission effort to keep them abroad on the mission field.
Happy birthday to you.
may not get up, but I'm down here. Wow. That just brings tears to my eyes. That's so sweet. Appreciate you girls and boys for singing to us today. Happy birthday, Jesus. You're a blessing to me. Jody, can we go ahead? All right. Let's all sing together. All right. We have a major sing with us.
Jesus, the sweet one. you. Y'all come right ahead. You know, we had Zach in for 1 day, or 2 days last week. He flew in on Saturday, and he flew out on Wednesday. And Zach and I thoroughly enjoyed their visit. He didn't get to visit along with his mother. But we thoroughly enjoyed it. Zach says, pray for them. In China, it's harder than ever before to reach out with the gospel of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So be in continuous prayer. Turn, if you will, in your Bible this morning to Matthew chapter 1. Bill, it doesn't get any sooner than Matthew, does it? That's the first book in the New Testament. Matthew chapter 1, 21. Now, we've all read the Christmas story many times at our homes and around our Christmas tree, in church, different places. But in Matthew chapter 1, verse 21, we find the Christmas story. This is what the Word of God says. And she will bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sin. Let us pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you today, and Lord, we realize that if you do not speak to our heart this morning through the power of the Holy Spirit, that we will not understand the true Christmas story. And Lord, we ask that you do that. You speak to our hearts, and Lord, move our hearts to repent. Lord, turn our lives around. Lord, let us get on fire for God. And we'll give you the praise, for it's in your precious name, the name of Jesus, we ask these things. Amen. Several years ago, in the little town of Bethlehem, was thinking about canceling the Christmas activities because of the feelings and the protests that were going on in Israel. And I've noticed that in our own area, in our own lives, in the United States alone, that we have shortened our Christmas. We sometimes, I haven't seen it so much lately, but it's written with an X and then must. And a lot of times we say happy holidays instead of Merry Christmas because we don't want to offend people about saying the name of Christ. Well, you know, we honor many things in America. It upsets me when we don't salute the flag. We see people not wanting to honor our veterans. To honor those that have gone on before us, we salute them, and we honor them. And I don't know about you, but I get a little aggravated to see people not doing that. I was taught that when you see the flag, you salute it, and you honor those that have given their lives for the freedom that we have in America. Now, how would you feel if you were God and we didn't honor his son on his birthday? You see, but that's what we have done. I heard a little boy one time wrote a letter to his grandma. He said, "Grandmother, I am so sorry that I forgot your birthday. But I'm writing to this letter so you won't forget mine." It's amazing how conveniently we forget about Christmas as Christ's birthday. I was talking to my wife this morning or last night or, the days just run together this past week. You know, I recently read a list of the most popular Christmas songs in America. And those songs were Chestnuts Roasting on an Open Fire, we've heard that one. I'm Dreaming of a White Christmas. Silver Bells. I'll Be Home for Christmas. Walking in a Winter Wonderland. And the old favorite, Jingle Bells. Now, I think about these songs and the popular for our holidays. You go into any store and they're playing some of these songs. But not one of them mentioned Christ's name in them. they're empty of the Christmas of Christ. The true story of Christmas starts with the cradle, continues to the cross, and concludes with the crown. Now you think about those things, from the cradle to the cross to the crown. And I do not believe you should shorten, I do not believe that we should have a Christ on a cross anymore, because he's the risen Lord. And when we see our crosses, we see them just a cross. Christ is not on the cross. He's in heaven today. He's the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, and he's in control of our universe. Now, the Christmas story is found in this verse. It's the story of man's sin. This little baby named Jesus, the Bible says, came to save his people from their sins. Now, this clues us in on some very important things. You see, when we read this verse of Scripture about the Christmas story, that Christ came to save his people from their sin, it has some bad news. Bad news. When an angel approached, announced Jesus' birth, he said to the shepherds in the hills that night, "I bring good tidings of great joy." And he said to the shepherds, "I have some good news for you." Now, why is Christmas good news? Simply because it is the remedy for the bad news. You see, Christ's coming is the good news for the remedy of the bad news, which is man is spiritually lost in sin. We have a sinful nature. We're depraved. Isaiah 53:6 says this, "All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every eye or every one into his own way." Every single one of us, the Bible says, are sinners. All have gone astray. Paul says in Romans 3:23, "All have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Solomon, the wisest man in all the Bible, says in Ezekiel 4:20, "For there is not a just man on earth who does good and does not sin." And then the Lord himself looked down upon the earth in Psalm 14:3 and says, "They are all gone astray. Everyone's gone astray. They are all together become filthy. There is none that doeth good. No, not one." You see, the Bible simply says man is spiritually dead. We're lost in our sinful ways. The good news about Christmas is that Christ came to save man from his sin. Not only is man spiritually depraved, man is spiritually destitute. The bad news becomes even worse news because there is no human way that we can save ourselves from the sickness, the Bible says, of sin. We have a terminal illness inside each one of us, and it causes a physical death. It causes a spiritual death. You can wash with the rags of righteousness and still be dirty. You can bathe in the waters of rituals in which we seem to do so much at Christmas, and the Bible says we're still lost in our sin. We can scrub with the soap of religion, and it will not get us into heaven. You cannot remove the stain of sin upon our lives. The Bible says all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. There's not one of us in here this morning that are good enough on our own to get into heaven. That's the bad news that we have of Christmas. Jeremiah 2:22 says, though you wash with lye. Now let me tell you something. Lye soap, woo, grandmother used to make it on the old fire out there, and she'd make lye soap. Man, and let me tell you, when you bathe in lye soap, you've got the softest skin. And you ever bathed in it? I have. I bathed in it because that's all we had. And you know what? You'd be soft. It washed you just as white as could be. Oh, he says, though you wash with lye soap and take much soap, yet thine iniquity is marked before me, saith the Lord God. All the lye soap in the world cannot get you into heaven. An ocean of perfume cannot remove the stench from what sin does to our Christian or to our lives. All the church attendance that we might have will not get us to heaven. Man is destitute and depraved. Not only is that, man is desperate. Desperate. Not only are we helpless, we can't do a thing to get ourselves into heaven. We're hopeless. Without hope, the Bible says. Without hope. I can't think of anything more terrifying than someone that lives their life without any hope whatsoever. You see, we are bound up in our sinfulness by sin's dominion. Jesus Christ said we become a slave to sin. Whoever commits sin is a slave of sin. The Bible says in Romans 6:23, the wages of that sin is death. The wages of sin is death. And then it says, but. Aren't you glad for that little connecting word? But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. You see, Christmas is a story about sinfulness of man. No sin, there would be no Savior. No Savior, there would be no Christmas. You see, sin, that's the Christmas story. He said, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save the people from their sin. You know, it's a story of sin, but it's also a story of God's Son. The Bible tells us in the beginning in the human race, over in Genesis chapter 3, the Bible says, God said, I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed, and it will bruise his head, thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. It started way back in Genesis in the very beginning, the story of God's Son. Isaiah 7:14 says, behold, the virgin shall conceive. Now, let me tell you something. Some people think that only the New Testament talks about Jesus Christ. But the Bible is full of Christ. It's the very beginning in Genesis to the book of Revelation. The virgin shall conceive and bear a son and shall call his name Emmanuel. Isaiah 9:6 says, for unto us a child is born, unto a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulders, and his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Isn't that wonderful? That the Christmas story is all about sin, but it's all about God, his Son. You see, away in a manger, we sing that a while ago, I believe it was. Away in a manger, oh, little town of Bethlehem, are great. But just as great as the old rugged cross. You see? The old rugged cross. The Bible talks about sin. The Bible talks about the Savior. And from the time Jesus Christ was born, he was under the shadow of the cross. Think about it. He was going to the cross. And the Bible says this, but when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of a woman, born under the law to redeem those who were under the law, and Jesus came to redeem and pay for sin. So the Bible is a story, Christmas is a story of sin. It's a story of God's Son, Jesus Christ, and it's also a story, and I love this, of salvation. Folks, if you're here this morning and you don't know God's salvation, you've never received Jesus Christ by faith, you've missed Christmas. All you going through all the rituals, you're going through the tree and the lights and the shopping and all of that, but you missed Christmas, because Christmas is God. It's about our sin. It's about our Savior who came to die for our sin, and it's about salvation. You see, behold, he says, I bring good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. Isn't that wonderful? Jesus says, whosoever shall call on my name shall be saved. One of the greatest truths we find in the Bible is whosoever will may come. Whosoever will may come to Jesus Christ. It doesn't say you have to clean up your life to start with. You just come to Christ. One of the greatest songs I believe ever written, and we've heard it over and over, is Just As I Am. I used to watch Billy Graham Crusade, and they played that, I believe, on every invitation. Just as I am, without one plea, I come. I come. That's how you have to come to Christ, just as you are. You see, God takes you and changes your life. It's complimentary. It's to everyone without cost. The greatest passage of Scripture, I guess one of the greatest passages, is God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Now, what did we miss there? We missed that word gave. God gave his Son. You didn't have to do anything for it. God gave his Son. In that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. God commended his love towards us. In that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. That needs to sink into our head. We realize that that is salvation. It's to all. It's a gift of God. It's amazing what people will pay for a sporting ticket. Man, I don't know how much a game costs nowadays, but I haven't went to them, but I'm sure they're at least $50 or something like that. And I may be so far out, it costs you that much to park, don't it? Amen. But it's amazing what people will pay for something. But when it comes to receiving the greatest gift of eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord, we won't even walk down an aisle and say, I want Christ as my Savior. You see, it don't make much sense, does it? But heaven's ticket is absolutely free. All you need to do, Jesus says, is come. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Trust him as your Savior, and you will be saved. What does that mean? It means that you need to realize this morning that Christmas is about sin. All have sinned. That means we all have that sinful nature. And it's about Jesus Christ, God's Son, coming to die on the cross that we might have salvation. And what we need to do is repent. We leave that word out. Let me tell you something. When we repent, we turn our lives around. It's as though I'm walking in this direction. I'm heading my life towards hell. I'm living for the devil. But I come to the point in my life that I just can't do anything but trust Christ. And I realize I need a Savior. And I realize that Christ died and his blood was shed on the cross for me. And I turn my life around and say, Lord, I want you in my life. And the Bible says he comes into our life and he seals us and we start walking towards Christ. Oh, we're like a little child. We'll crawl at first, Oh, but then we're walking towards Christ, whatever strength of energy we have, and His power which is in us, and He guides us through life, and He helps us through life. As we study His Word, we become more like Him. You see, it is complete. It is forever He saves us. I've gotten a few gifts at Christmas that I've had to take back. Store, take them back, and they'll ask you, do you got a piece of paper that you can return this with, a receipt? And I'll usually say, no, I've lost it. But would you please take it back? And they'll take it back. You know, this body doesn't fit into 32s anymore. It'd be like trying to pour yourself into a Coke bottle. It don't even fit into 40s no more. But I take them back. But you know what? When Christ gives you eternal life, it's always just right. And He don't have to. You don't have to take it back. It doesn't. It always fits. It's always the right style. You see, it's eternal life that He gives us. Eternal life. And He said, it's eternal, folks. How long is eternal? Forever and ever. And I don't know. But it's a long time. You see, that's what He gives you. The story of Christmas this morning is simple. It is the story of Christ who came to save His people from their sin. It's a story about God's Son who went to the cross, who died upon that old rugged cross, that we might have eternal life. I read of a physician one time that he was a good doctor and he was devoted to the Lord, and he loved all of his patients that came in. The ones that could pay, paid. The ones that couldn't pay, he marked in red, too poor to pay. Too poor to pay. And after each one of those lines, too poor to pay, he wrote beside it in red ink, forgiven. 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 He died. And his wife, she was not so kind and generous. She wanted all those patients to pay for all that he had done. And she'd found that little book. She carried it to a judge. And she said, I want these people to pay their debt that they owed to my husband, who was faithful and devoted. The judge took one look at that book, and he threw it out of court. He said, no court, no judge would ever rule in favor of you, especially when the physician has written forgiven. You see, folks, Jesus Christ died on the cross, and beside our names, as we come to Him by faith, our sin debt, He writes, forgiven. Forgiven. For all eternity. Forgiven. There's nothing that you can do to erase the blood of Jesus Christ. Christmas is more than Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. It's more than jingle bells. It's more than white snow. Christmas is about Christ. A baby born in a manger in Bethlehem. A baby who came to die for our sin. And upon the throne today He's seated as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And if you will come this morning and simply realize, you know, I'm a sinner. I want Jesus Christ as my Savior. He will mark by your name, forgiven. by the blood of Jesus Christ. And one day, when you stand before the throne, God will say, "Welcome home. Welcome home, my child. You have been forgiven." Don't you want that greatest gift? How can we celebrate Christmas and leave Christ out? I don't know. But if you want Christ as your Lord and Savior, you must come just like He said. There's only one way, and that's through Jesus Christ, His Son. So if you don't have Christ this morning, here's the invitation. Would you simply come just as you are and say, "Preacher, I want to trust Christ this morning. I want to give my life to Him this morning. I want to repent. I want to start walking towards Christ." And would you do that with all your heart? The Bible says the moment you trust Him by faith, you shall be saved. Maybe you're here and you're already a child of God, but you realize, "Man, I've left my first love," like we talked about Wednesday night. "I've lost that fire inside that I once had." You might just want to come and kneel at the altar. Or if you can't kneel, just sit on the front pew and say, "Lord, with all my heart, I want that first fire back in my life." You see, I don't believe you're too old to serve God. If you're here this morning, He's got you here for a reason. And maybe you're here this morning and you're looking for a church home, and this is the place God's led you and you want to join. Well, would you just come and say, "Preacher, I'd like to join up with this church that we might serve Christ together right here in Gun Barrel City." Whatever decisions that God is leading you to make, do that right now. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank You today for the story of Christmas. We thank You for Your Son. We thank You, Lord, that You came to save us from our sin. Now, Lord, let the Holy Spirit move, touch people's lives, and change their lives. For it's in Christ's name we ask it. Amen.